Good morning. Today we're going to do a typical introductory vector addition problem where we need to use component vectors. Here we go.
Hey guys.
Hey Bob.
Hi Bob.
Flippin' physics.
Bo, could you please read the problem?
Slow velocity racer races 50.0 centimeters east, then turns 35 degrees north of east, and scoots for 40.0 centimeters. She then turns and moseys another 30.0 centimeters north. What was her total displacement?
There are clearly vectors in this problem, however, the problem description does not give these vectors names. And this is something you will periodically run into when you're solving problems. I do suggest that you always give your vectors names because this will make it easier to identify which vectors you are working with while you are solving the problem. I have named the vectors A, B, and C. Vector A is 50.0 centimeters east. Vector B is 40.0 centimeters at an angle of 35 degrees north of east. And vector C is 30.0 centimeters north. We are trying to find the total displacement for slow velocity racer, which works out to be the sum of the three vectors A, B, and C, which is the resultant vector R. Now, whenever you are doing a vector addition problem, you need to draw a vector diagram. I start by drawing vector A, which is 50 centimeters east, and notice that this vector is an arrow to indicate its direction, and it has a label A with a vector symbol over it to identify that this arrow is representing vector A. I place the tail of vector B on the tip of vector A because this is tip-to-tail vector addition. Notice that B is about 4/5 the length of A because it represents 40 centimeters in length instead of 50 centimeters in length. And we have our angle here, which is 35 degrees north from east, or north of east. And vector C, the tail of vector C, is on the tip of vector B. C is northward and is only 3/5 the length of A because it represents 30 centimeters in length. We are looking for the total displacement, which is this resultant vector R, which is the displacement from the initial points to the final point. And the arrowhead goes right here on the final point, again, because this arrow indicates the direction of the total displacement, which is from the initial point to the final point. Now, some students want to put this arrowhead on the resultant vector down here instead. Now, I've drawn it this way, which is wrong. Please make sure you realize that, because a lot of students want to draw it this way. And I think it's because vector A goes this way, B this way, C this way. You want to go back to the beginning. It makes you feel all warm and fuzzy inside, because then you have this loop, and you can just keep going around in the loop. But that's wrong. Okay? Remember, this resultant vector is the sum of A, B, and C, so it's going to start at the beginning of A and end at the end of C. So the resultant vector goes from the initial to the final point, and we indicate that by having the arrowhead go from the initial to the final point. So this resultant vector arrowhead should go up here on the final point. Another thing I want to point out is that a lot of students want to draw their vector diagrams like this. You guys would be like,
hey, Mr. P, I drew my vector diagram.
And I'm like,
no, you didn't. That ain't no vector diagram.
Class, what is this?
That is a quadrilateral.
You could also call it a quadrangle or a tetragon, but quadrilateral is probably what it's most often called.
Yes, you can call this a quadrilateral, a quadrangle, a tetragon, or even just a polygon, but you certainly cannot call it a vector diagram. This is a vector diagram. Notice, arrows indicating the direction of the vectors and labels to identify the vector names. Please draw vector diagrams, not polygons.
I'm in the math club.
At this point, we can't use the Pythagorean theorem or because we don't even have a triangle.
We could draw a line from the start of vector A to the end of vector B, and then we could use the law of cosines to determine the length of that line, and then
Bo, please stop. Absolutely, Bo. I'm sure we could find a way to draw some lines up here and use the law of sines, the law of cosines, all those things to solve this particular problem. But rather than give you an individualized approach to an individual problem, I always try to give you guys a general approach that will work in all situations. In the long run, you will all understand it better. The general approach to solving vector addition problems is to use what we learned in our last lesson about breaking or resolving vectors into their component vectors. Bobby, could you please break vector B into its component vectors in the x and y directions?
Oh, right, that's a right triangle, so...
solve would be fine.
Yeah, we can use sine theta equals opposite over hypotenuse, and opposite the angle is b in the y direction, and the hypotenuse is the vector b, multiply by b to solve for vector b in the y direction, and b sub y equals b times the sine of theta, or 40 times the sine of 35, which is 22.943 centimeters.
Correct. And Billy, how do we find the component of vector b in the x direction?
Cosine theta equals adjacent over hypotenuse, or the component of b in the x direction over vector b. Multiply by b to get b in the x direction equals b times the cosine of theta, or 40 times the cosine of 35, which is equal to...
32.766 centimeters.
Yeah.
Great, now we have the component vectors of b in the x direction and b in the y direction. Bobby, please explain to me why we don't need to break vectors c and a into their component vectors.
Oh, because A and C are already directly in either the X or Y direction, and therefore they don't need to be broken into components in the X or Y direction.
Yes. Now notice what happens when we redraw our vector diagram, and instead of using vector B, we draw in the components of vector B. Now we have a right triangle, and we can use and the Pythagorean theorem to determine our resultant vector. Now please notice that I've labeled this angle as phi. This angle right here is phi, which is different than our angle theta for our vector b, because this is the angle for the direction of our resultant vector. Bo, could you please figure out phi, the angle for our resultant vector?
We can use tangent phi equals opposite over adjacent, and opposite the angle is c plus b in the y direction, and adjacent is a plus b in the x direction. Taking the inverse tangent of the whole equation gives us that phi equals the inverse tangent of the quantity c plus b in the y direction divided by a plus b in the x direction. With numbers, that is the inverse tangent of 30 plus 22.943 divided by 50 plus 32.766, which works out to be
32.606 degrees, and my calculator is in degree mode, so I know I'm right.
I'm in the physics club, too.
Excuse me a sec.
What are you babbling about?
Well, what I said was I'm in the math club, the Latin club, and the physics club.
Yep, the angle of 32.606 degrees will give us the direction. And now we need the magnitude. Bobby, could you please find the magnitude?
We can use the Pythagorean theorem, so a squared plus b squared equals c squared, or the resultant vector squared equals the quantity of a plus b in the x direction squared plus the quantity b in the y direction plus c squared. Taking the square root of the whole equation gives us the resultant vector equals the square root of, the quantity of a plus b in the x direction squared plus the quantity b in the y direction plus c, that quantity squared. With numbers, that is the square root of 50 plus 32.766 squared plus 22.943 plus 30, that quantity squared. Which works out to be
98.251 centimeters.
And with two sig phase, the resultant vector or total displacement of our slow velocity racer is 98 centimeters at an angle of 33 degrees north of east, because this angle phi is 33 degrees northward from east. Now, let's just review what this means for a moment. Slow velocity racer can travel the vectors A, B, and C, or the vectors A, B in the x direction, B in the y direction, and C, or even just the resultant vector R, and she will still start and end in the same location and therefore have the exact same total displacement. That is what we just figured out. Any questions?
No, thanks.
I'm good.
In that case, let's review. We started by giving our vectors names. We then drew our vector diagram, which was had arrows and labels for all of our vectors. We broke vector B into its components in the x and y direction. Then we redrew our vector diagram. And because we had a right triangle, then we were able to use the Pythagorean theorem and SOHCAHTOA to solve for our resultant vector. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.